So we just recapped different layout managers and looked at how you'd use various layouts together to create some example screens. As you probably noticed, we started using these circles and buttons and toolbars. Let's start diving a little deeper into what some of those elements were and why they keep appearing all over the place. Now, each application is an individual snowflake with different content and goals. Just because they're unique, though, doesn't mean that we should force users to learn new conventions to operate them. By following some established patterns of the platform, you can accelerate your users' understanding of the app, making it feel intuitive. Imagine if every model of car had a different layout of the pedals, the steering wheel, and the levers. While you might be able to learn one model, you'd have a hard time moving to another. Your UI is exactly the same. By following some conventions, users can quickly get in and drive your app. Here are some of the most prevalent patterns used on Android to organize your interface and navigate around it. A toolbar is a horizontal bar which provides a standard way to present titles and actions in your layout. It's made up of a navigation area on the left, a title area, and a menu of actions. It's a very flexible widget, and each of these functions is optional. A nice feature is that the toolbar can show actions either directly within the toolbar, or they can be collapsed under a submenu known as an overflow if there isn't enough room. And it can base its decision on whether there's enough room to show everything. Tapping the overflow item itself yields this overflow menu of additional actions you can take. The toolbar itself is a view group, so you can add children to it. For example, I could add a spinner control as a child view to provide some kind of navigational control. Now, toolbars are used extensively in Android, so they're very recognizable to your users and a common place to look for actions or present them. They generally use a standard height, which varies by screen size, and can be queried using the action bar size theme attribute. They're also a great place to embed your brand's color. Next, the app bar. The app bar is just a special case of the toolbar where it's placed at the very top of the screen. As such, the title field often provides a screen title, and the navigation icon provides access to screen level navigation options. The app bar often uses an extended height to provide more space for branding or to contain a hero image. In this case, it's usually multiples of the standard height. Next up, tabs. Tabs let you organize and navigate to different sections within your screen or app. On Android, tabs always appear at the top of the screen, and you can switch between them using a horizontal swipe gesture. Generally, they sit on the same surface as your app bar if you're using one. Now, tabs can be a great way to provide the main way of navigating about your app, or providing sub-navigation if you're using a different top-level navigation construct, such as a navigation drawer. Now, a navigation drawer is a panel that slides in from the left of the screen and contains top-level navigation options to different parts of your application. The drawer itself can be divided into sections and frequently provides access to account information here in this top area. Now, the drawer is closely associated with the so-called hamburger icon, this three-line icon in your toolbar. Either pressing this or dragging from the left edge of your device will open the drawer. The drawer can work well if you have a number of different sections that you want to provide quick navigation to without taking up persistent space on every screen. However, if you don't need this, say if you only have a few sections to navigate between, then a different pattern, like tabs, might be more relevant as they're going to be more obvious to your users. It's also important to use restraint and thoughtfully select items to put in the navigation drawer. It shouldn't become a dumping ground for all the things. Android also has pretty common patterns around scrolling and paging. Users are typically comfortable with scrolling vertically to see more information on a screen. Horizontal scrolling is less common, especially with text content, as it can be frustrating to read. More common is to use a horizontal gesture to page through content, so each gesture takes you to one discrete page back or forward. So for example, if you're reading emails or news stories, then it's a very useful pattern. Horizontal paging is especially common for a details view launched from a list where you have a mental model of what the next page of items might be. Note that as we just covered in the tab section, horizontal swipe should change pages between tabs, so therefore it's kind of incompatible to use both tabs and horizontally paged content. Another extremely common pattern on Android is list to detail, where you would show a list of individual items, and clicking on one would take you to a subsequent detail screen. You've probably used this 100 times, such as viewing your contacts or reading news stories, for example. A variation on this pattern is to show both the list and details sections on the same screen on larger devices. So here, these two screens would be separate on a small device and brought together on a larger device. Showing just a list on a large screen can look awkward and leave a lot of empty space. Additionally, showing both items at once can allow you to retain more context about the activity you're performing and prevents what we call pogo sticking, where the user is forced to go into a details and back up and into a details and back up. We'll go into much more detail on other patterns for larger screens in lesson 5. Now, it's absolutely okay to deviate from these patterns if and when it makes sense for your specific use case. These are patterns, after all, not strict rules. But make sure you're doing so for good reasons, as you'll be asking your users to learn a bespoke interaction. The phrase I like to use here is deviate with purpose. Picking an application structure and navigation scheme depends on the content in your application. A good exercise is to sketch out an entity relationship diagram. This shows the objects in your application and how they relate to each other. Once you understand this, you can pick an application structure to match.